All right, good morning. Fair play for getting out of bed. Fair play for getting here in the rain. Fair play to Ray and others for coming up from Cork and for wherever people came to. You're very welcome to the 10th annual Anarchist Bookfair. I don't know how many people have been here for all 10, but a few, I think. I think this is my fourth or fifth, and I think I'm only involved because of longevity, not for any other reason. So the session today, as you know, is called Voting for Marriage Equality While Being Critical of Marriage. But the panel is diverse within that topic. Some people are slightly more critical than others, but sure, that's the point of the discussion. And we'll see how we get on. Five wonderful speakers, beautiful, enthusiastic, happy to be here. Of course they are, not nervous at all, I'm sure. And what we're going to do is go through, each speaker is going to take between 5 to 8 minutes, maybe 4 to 8 minutes for somebody to give the little spiel that they've prepared, which I imagine is based on a mixture of political thinking and personal stories, and God knows, you'll hear yourself. And then we'll finish up then, and then we'll have a question and answer session. And I think everyone's looking forward to that part in particular as well. So that's it, we'll launch in. No need to hear from me. So the first speaker is Fionnghuala Nic Roibeaird. Thank you. Fionnghuala is a queer anarcho-feminist from Belfast and is also a member of WSM, and can explain more about yourself as you get going.
Yep. So I want to start off, before I turn into marriage, basically saying that I am calling for a yes vote, and the reason I'm doing so is because I have to acknowledge my own privilege of growing up in a household where my parents recognised that I was a tomboy and was happy enough just playing football or action men with the boys, and didn't bother speaking to me about marriage, and they knew not to mention the topic, whereas my other two sisters were absolutely consumed with the idea of getting married someday. So I think what we really need to do then, after the yes vote goes through, is encourage people to reject marriage. And I want to talk why I think we should reject marriage. And I really don't think it's enough for me to say that I'm critical of marriage. I think it's more accurate to say that I hate it. And among the queer community, I think we have two groupings of people. So we have people who want queer acceptance in a straight society, and we have people who want absolutely nothing to do with what we have now. They want to completely change the rules. And because of the horrors that have been contained within marriage, I don't see anything loving or romantic about it. It's been a bourgeois patriarchal tool to trap women, to control our sexualities, to force us to reproduce, and then force reproductive labour that goes along with it. As well as that, I think marriage really reinforces the nuclear family, which is an anarchist feminist, I believe, is the basis of all authoritarian systems. The lesson that the child learns from the parents is to obey, and to obey the faceless voice of authority. And I think then what we really have to get into is smashing the nuclear family, and I don't think that through marriage equality that will be done at all. We can't forget that it wasn't that long ago that all young girls and women were being taught was to be the perfect housewife. And Emma Goldman really nailed it whenever she said that marriage is primarily an economic arrangement or an insurance pact. And she's right, because marriage makes it a lot easier to concentrate power, privilege and property into family ties, and to concentrate all these things within them. And it makes it a lot easier for them to move from one person to the other, that person generally coming from the same stock of privilege. And the family has remained the state's most efficient way to corral the family into a source of revenue. Look, raising a family isn't cheap. You know, all this stuff, it takes money, there's insurance, there's housing, and while it's not the case up north, down south you do have to pay for doctors' bills and stuff. And the danger from the marriage equality movement is the homonormative queer, so these are people who want the society that we have now, they're happy enough to stay in it. And the only reason really that it's not such a radical idea to talk about marriage equality now is because these homonormative queers, they generally want or have positions of financial or political power. So then I fit the criteria for going into marriage and concentrating all this wealth and privilege. And what we have happening here is people organising around people and an idea that is normal or acceptable to society as we have it. And this isn't uncommon for social justice movements. Like, we just have to take feminism, for example, where you have SWERFs and TERFs. So these are the undesirables in society. You know, they're not going to be that taken into the mainstream. It's not as acceptable an idea. And I really don't think that we can talk about queer liberation without talking about the hetero patriarchy. And Andrea Smith, a Native American scholar, describes a hetero patriarchy as the way our society is fundamentally based on male dominance, a dominance inherently built on a gender binary system that presumes heterosexuality as a social norm. And the idea that the male sex was meant to biologically dominate over the female sex paved the way for it to be acceptable for the social elites to dominate over the rest of us. And I'm meant to be talking in a northern context as well, and we literally have the hetero patriarchy as the majority party up north. The DUP, they're openly homophobic. Of the 38 MLAs they have, only 5 of them are women. Statistically, they're the worst up in Stormont, with only 30% female representation, and they don't have any policy to improve this figure. And I don't know if it's just because I'm back living in Belfast, because I was away for 2 years, but I feel like homophobia is getting a lot worse up north. We had Ishers there last May, it's still ongoing, where a service was advertised, and it was advertised to all, and some man came in asking, it was a gay rights activist, asking for a cape to be printed with Bert and Ernie on it and the words "support gay marriage," and everything was fine and dandy. He went away, got a phone call, and he says, "Oh, sorry, this goes against our deeply held religious beliefs, we won't be doing this." So then we've had a court case by the Human Rights Commission coming out of that, and it just feels like there's been a massive backlash. We've had the DUP calling for a conscience clause so that it's now legal to refuse service to queers on the basis that they are queer. We then had the Girls Brigade coming out, which is the largest youth organisation in the north, teaching young girls that if you're gay, you're as bad as a rapist or a murderer. And then just 2 days ago there, we had Jim Wells, the health minister, come out with this absolute nonsense, saying that if a child is raised in, as he calls it, a homosexual household, they are, the facts apparently are that they are far more likely to be abused or neglected. Like, this is a minister, like, and just like the Islamophobia that happened from Peter Robinson last summer, he will stay in his position because that's the way the North is built. It's built on colonialism, and colonialism operates through patriarchy. Violence against women was used against colonised people to render them inherently rapable, their lands inherently invadable, and their resources inherently extractable. That's another quote from Smith there. But just to finish up, marriage equality, just like voting, it gives the illusion of changing the system while keeping those same structures in place. And I just want to finish with a quote by the radical queer group Against Equality that says, even if you wrap it in a rainbow flag, a cop is a cop, a wall is a wall, an occupation is an occupation, a marriage license is a tool of regulation.
Thanks, Fionnghuala. Speaker number two is Paul McAndrew. He's a non-monogamous gay man living in Cork, and he's also a member of WSM.
So I'd like to begin by saying that although I'm basically going to defend equal marriage, like Fionnghuala, I'm going to start by acknowledging that I recognise a lot of validity in the opposite position, and that I agree with most of what Fionnghuala said. But I think although we oppose the whole system of waged labour, for example, that doesn't mean that we don't fight for better conditions and wages within wage labour as it exists at the moment. And we don't judge somebody working in McDonald's because they're working for McDonald's. We fight with them to get better wages and conditions. And I think, although I have zero interest in getting married myself, I don't feel that as a left-wing activist, I have the right to impose my views on other people who might not be activists. Do you know that I meet a lot of people in the movement against water charges who are married couples, and I don't want to be saying to them, I oppose your choices in how you live your life. And I think one of the things that's a bit contradictory in a way a lot of us approach things is that although when we're talking about equal marriage for trans and bi and gay people, we often express serious reservations. I've never heard one of my straight comrades being challenged because they're married. And a lot of my straight comrades who have married have done so for complicated practical reasons, things like migration status, or I was talking to one of my comrades the other day about why she'd chosen to marry, and it's because she has 4 children and only 2 of the children are biologically related to her partner, and she wants to make sure that her partner has a relationship legally, can visit his kids in hospital if they're in trouble, or she says, if something happens to me and I get killed, I want to know that they get to stay in their family, which they know and they follow every day. I agree that marriage and the nuclear family have been core institutions of the patriarchy. But I think the marriage at the moment functions as one of the core means of binary gender. You know, you get that exaggerated image of the masculine man and the woman in the flimsy dress at the altar. And that when you have that with no man involved, when there's 2 women getting married, it actually has the potential to disrupt that very important image which is imposed onto people. So I think there are ways in which it can actually be useful to play with what we've been had imposed on us, rather than try and immediately evolve past it. I love Emma Goldman's writings, and another thing she said about marriage was that people only moralise about prostitution when it's outside of marriage. And I would, my approach to marriage would be similar to my attitude to sex work, in that, of course, people shouldn't have to do either to get decent housing or the income that they need, or citizenship status, the right to live in which country. But in practice, at the moment, people have to do things for complicated reasons in order to survive in the fucked up capitalist world. And like I say, I don't feel I have the right, as somebody who is imposed to marriage for myself, I don't feel I have the right to let people have fewer choices given to them by the state because they're queer. I can't tolerate the fact that there are openly homophobic laws being imposed on me. I grew up in Thatcher's Britain, and Clause 28, and one of the great things about Clause 28 is it really brought together a political movement of queer people, and especially...
do you want to explain what it is, just in case?
Yeah, sorry.
Thanks.
It's very... People have probably heard of Putin's law in Russia at the moment, which makes it illegal to say anything positive about gay people, the gay propaganda law. The Clause 28 started when there was a scandal about a book called Jenny Lives with Eric and Martin, and it was in a school library in London, and it was about a little girl who had 2 dads, and the right-wing press got hold of it, and, you know, like, these evil people corrupting our kids. And Thatcher passed this law, which meant that anything funded by a local authority, by a local council, couldn't say anything positive about gay people, and couldn't pretend that their relationships were family relationships. They described them as pretended family relationships. And what that meant was, for example, my dad, who taught English, felt inhibited from teaching certain writers because it contained queer scenes and the school had funding from the local authority. And libraries felt inhibited from getting queer books. So that's just a bit of background about why I feel so passionately that I can't tolerate having openly transphobic and homophobic laws in the states where we have to live. That's about it.
Great, thanks. Okay, our next speaker is Aidan Rowe. Aidan is a queer activist and, queer anarchist activist and writer based in Dublin.
Okay, so I think like the two speakers before me, I'm also advocating a yes vote. And I think basically because that's the pragmatic situation is that the queer movement isn't strong enough to really represent an alternative that's realisable. And there are practical reasons why people, why queer people need to get married now. Some of the stuff that Paul was talking about in terms of migration, in terms of children, in terms of access to adoption and things like that. And I think it would be irresponsible to say this isn't good enough and not vote in a situation where we're not strong enough to really push for an alternative. I also think in terms of like broader political stuff, like for example the struggle for abortion rights, I think a strong yes vote could have important impacts in relation to that, because I think the sense of what's possible politically in this country is largely constructed around an idea of what the balance of forces between like people like the Iona Institute and people like us is. And I think a strong rejection of the Iona Institute and the Catholic Church's position on this issue could have important effects in terms of changing our sense of what's possible. I think that's important. But I'm not going to be celebrating a yes vote. I'm not particularly excited about the prospect of a yes vote. Because I don't think this really represents a victory for us. I think what it represents is the success of conservative elements within our own movement in dominating and narrowing the agenda of our politics. I think it represents the success of societal conservative and homophobic forces in recuperating and recapturing the potential for a more radical transformation that was opened up with the post-Stonewall gay liberation movement and their strategies of repression and violence, and then gradually rolling out a kind of, you can have these rights, you can have this form of equality under these specific conditions. So I think in different circumstances, I would be calling for a no vote. I think if we were strong, if there was a strong, highly organised, radical queer movement that could, within a realistic time frame, push for a better change, to push for like the abolition of state marriage in its entirety, the decoupling of all these rights from a specific norm as to what a relationship should look like, and legal and cultural and social acceptance for a broader range of forms of relationship and kinship and affinity. I think if that was realistic, I would certainly be saying this is not good enough, we should vote no. So in terms of what I'm really interested in is what we do next, like what happens after this referendum goes through. I think the reality is that like certain people are talking about this as like a stepping stone, and we like a place to jump off for like greater liberation or whatever. I think it's the opposite. I think the historical experience from feminist struggle, from anti-racist struggles, is that when these movements win partial reforms, there's usually a massive demobilization. The people for whom this reform is good enough are probably not coming back for the rest of us. The people who like just want to get married and that's the end of their politics are not coming back to talk about the gender recognition bill, for example, or to talk about some form of recognition for polyamorous relationships. They're not coming back for that. So I think we're looking at a situation where we have to rebuild, where we have to recognise that there's no longer a basis for unity between queers and the more mainstream LGBT movement. I think it needs to be a moment of self-recognition from queers that we're not the same, that our political goals, our strivings, and our desires are not the same as what's represented by the mainstream movement. I think we need to look at building community and building relations of support, relations of care among one another, of starting to talk about queer liberation and, I think, the abolition of heteronormativity, or really the abolition of heterosexuality as kind of organising principle in which, like around which social institutions are designed. I think that's important for two reasons, because I think a strong queer community means we can take the critique of marriage and turn it into a concrete politics. Like, I've been putting forward this argument for a number of years, but the problem in the back of my mind all the time has been, well, this is a great critique, but what do we do with it? Like, how do we turn it into concrete action on the ground? I think the reality is we need to be stronger. There's loads of faces here that I don't recognise. I need to know you. We need to be working together. We need to be talking to each other. And we need to be building something towards the point where we can start to challenge heterosexuality and patriarchy and capitalism. Well, that's exactly where I wanted to stop. So that's perfect.
Thanks, Aidan, for timing. Our next speaker, fair play for all the concentration levels. Pretty impressive. Our next speaker is Janet O'Sullivan. Janet is a bisexual activist and particularly strong on bi-visibility activity in the mainstream, I suppose.
Hello, good morning. I'm not an anarchist, but I've been anarchist adjacent for many years. Let's start with that. I'm in favour of the referendum. I'm in favour of voting yes. I am enthused and really optimistic about the number of young people that have registered across the country. The number of young people who are getting engaged, who are using social media, who are asking questions, who are having conversations and feeling that they can make a change, that they can make a difference. It's something I'm really positive about. It's something I'm really looking forward to see how that changes and shakes up this country moving forward. If this referendum has done anything, it's done that, and I consider it a very positive thing. I'm in favour of marriage rights. I'm in favour of marriage, and I want more marriage, and I come from a very different point of view because I'm pagan. So while I absolutely despise the nuclear family, I think it's incredibly toxic. I think it isolates families and it isolates people away from their communities. It takes a village to raise a child, and the idea that two parents of whatever gender are all the all end all and be all for any child to be reared is wrong. It breaks us apart. It moves us away from family and community. We have rocketing cases where we've got postnatal depression, and parents, whatever the gender, been locked into the fact that for the first 2 years of staying the life of their offspring, they're isolated from everybody. Mm. And it breaks down communities and barriers. But the nuclear family is a very new idea. It was only in the 50s. It's only after we had so much gender stereotyping and gender roles smashed during World War II, and when they went to reconstruct society afterwards, and Rosie was told to hand in her rivets, we then see the Freudian principles coming in via the American mainstream, and we see the ideal 50s model housewife, we see the suit and tie short haircut man going out. So these definitions of what gender models are and gender behaviour are actually quite new. They're actually quite modern. We don't have to be beholden to them. In terms of saying, I want more marriage, well, I'm a pagan and I'm living in Ireland. So I go back to our pre-colonial laws on marriage, which are the Breton laws. And there were 14 different distinct marriages under Breton law. The first one being the soldier's marriage or warrior's marriage was of one night. So any couple that spent a night together for that time in that space under blankets or under stars, that was considered a marriage. particularly if that union, if it was possible to create a child, so there were no illegitimate children, end of. And then you've got various different ranks and matrices of marriage with different terms of responsibilities. Sometimes it was what's been seen in the pagan tradition was for 1 month, a marriage of 1 month, or what gets put into neo-pagan terms of a marriage of a year and a day, or 3 years, that marriage vows could be renewed. And in terms of divorce, well, you threw the other person's stuff out of your communal dwelling and go, I've had enough of you, instead of what we see is the 5 to 7 year length. Now, I've seen gay men, particularly, yes, very privileged gay men, complaining that marriage equality would remove the rights to dissolution of 1 year in civil partnership. You know, that they, if they got married, gay married, that they'd have to wait and go to the 5 to 7 years. So I'm for more marriage. I'm for more marriage diversity. I'm for not just sticking with, oh, no, we're changing marriage. Yeah, we changed it with divorce. We're going to change it again. I would like to see more different varying models of marriage brought into Irish law, going back to the Breton law, that there is the scope and tradition and heritage there. And if anybody's interested in reading up on them, you can find them on UCC's website, on the Celt website. You can look up the Breton laws pertaining to marriage. Yes, in some cases, but property. Yes, it's about status. But it's rights and responsibilities to each other and to the community, because the community will support the new couple coming together in any which way. And it's also what's known as the law of the couple, whatever genders or how many people are, I would see in that couple, in that people are, that people's relations are respected. That if a couple or a truple are having a private conversation about their lives or their dynamics, that they're given that space. That somebody, if somebody's staying in your house and they are a couple, for whatever way you want to define that, that they're given their own place to stay. So for me, how I treat people and how I see marriage defined and relationships defined goes back to that, and has very little to do with the imposed Edwardian and Victorian ideals which have been put on this country. So we don't have to just stick with what we've learned in this previous century. We can go back further. I dislike the marriage equality campaign. I really despise marriage equality as an organisation. They quite deliberately chose to perpetuate, yes, the biggest campaign nationally for apparently LGBT rights in this country, but they have left out completely trans people in their campaign. I was so delighted to see Tenney come out with the equality, the T is not silent, but that's only come out recently. And quite frankly, their national campaign is also perpetuating the biggest case of bi-erasure and biophobia in this country. So we're seeing words like marriage equality for gay and lesbian people, marriage equality for gay and lesbian couples. If I'm in a relationship with a woman, I'm not in a lesbian relationship, because that woman has to deal with me checking out a hot guy's ass as he walks by. You know, the dynamics are different. I'm always in a bisexual relationship because my bisexuality is how I am, it's who I am. It's if I'm not going out with anybody, because I am currently single, I don't become asexual. You know, if I'm in a relationship with a man, I'm not suddenly straight. And we see a lot of people being pushed out of queer spaces, and very much the mainstream LG, because I'm not going to, it is LG spaces, it's not LGBT spaces. Pushed out of the main LG spaces once you are in a relationship, because you've chosen, you've picked sides. Even more so if you become a breeder. Oh no, I have 2 kids. I can't be queer anymore. Yeah, that doesn't work that way. I've managed to bring up my children knowing about gender fluidity, knowing about gender identity, knowing about, you know, they might grow up to like a boy, or they might grow up to like a girl, or both, or nobody in that way. So while we do live in a society which is restricted to, because of the church, because of capitalism, yes, I know by Marxism, we queer that every day, and how we treat each other, and how conversations we have. And it's been an absolute delight to be complete and utter torn in the marriage equality side, which I have been, by coming up to meeting and saying, why haven't you mentioned bisexuality? By being online and being present. And that's what it takes, standing up and being counted, if you can. If you have the ability, if you have the confidence, and if you can look after yourself. Because those posters are nasty, we're not done, it's going to get more vicious as time moves forward, and we all have to look after each other.
Thanks. It's like you had an internal body clocking you exactly what I was going to say. So one more great speaker, and then we'll move on to the questions. Our next speaker is Bethany Lanagon, which I pronounced correctly because I'm getting better at Irish as we go on. And Beth has been active in radical trans women's circles for the past 2 decades. Her activism focuses on trans women.
So first off, I won't be voting for marriage equality because I'm not allowed to vote for referendums in this country, apparently. But while I'm critical of the institution of marriage, I'm not necessarily critical of marriage, and I'll explain that in a minute. So I still think everyone should vote yes. Sometimes the things you fight for aren't necessarily the things you end up winning. Sometimes they're even better. I'm going to go off marriage equality for a bit here, and I want to talk about some things that happened this week, because they're kind of a little bit related to this. Folks are going to have to excuse me for a bit for being a bit North American-centric, but I want to talk about some activism I've been involved in for 18 years now. Actually, even longer. My activism can legally drink in most countries around this. And I'm really excited about this because something happened this week. But I'm also really excited about this because it has been like 23 years I've been involved in this, and that means I never have to talk about it again. It's over. If folks don't know what the Michigan Women's Music Festival is, it's a 40-year-old women's music festival. It's women-only music festival, Heart, Michigan. In the early 90s, they kicked out a trans woman in the middle of the night, Nancy Jean Burkholder. And her crime was not being woman-born woman. About 18 years ago, I helped kick off a boycott of the bands that played this festival and helped kick off what became the second incarnation of Camp Trans, which was a protest camp outside the festival that took place for about 15 years. After years of protest around this, just this week, Lisa Vogel, the founder and owner of the festival, announced that she was shutting it down due to that it no longer being financially viable. Last year, they lost the Indigo Girls. So, some segments of the women, trans women's community are counting this as a win, and I'm not one of them. The festival essentially decided after years of pressure that they could have resolved with a simple policy change that they would rather take their ball and go home. And to me, that's not a win. It's a failure. And it's a good thing that admission to the festival was never something I was really fighting for. Some context here is necessary. In the United States and other places, the admission of trans women to women's and queer spaces has historically been a contentious issue. Trans women have been, for the past 45 years or so, purged from women's and trans or women's and queer communities. From Beth Elliott and the Daughters of Blightus, Sylvia Rivera and the predecessor of today's New York City Pride Parade, the inclusion of trans women has been spotty at best. And when the protests against Michigan happened, and this entirely changed the culture. So while it's far from perfect, the inclusion of trans women in women's culture in the US and Canada now is way more often considered a given rather than something that must be debated. And this has the entire conversation that started around this one protest has actually had real concrete effects. In the U.S., the nonprofit industry is a bit queer. Like, I don't know if that's the same here, but in the U.S., it's really queer. From homeless shelter, domestic violence programs, women health initiatives, it's generally queer assigned female at birth people who are involved in this, and they're very highly represented. And a lot of them dictate policy, and a lot of them went to Michigan Women's Music Festival and drank up a culture where trans women were considered less than. And then things changed. I want to read something that my little baby trans sister from the States wrote. She's an abortion provider in the Pacific Northwest. I just want to give my profound thanks to everyone who gave so much of themselves in this fight. I know Michigan Women's Music Festival closing was not what you wanted, and there was profound sadness that Vogel would choose to close rather than change. Unfortunately, there has always been people in the world that would rather burn down the plantation than share. Progress just has to go on without them. I am a trans woman, the medical director of the Feminist Women's Health Center. We are an activist nonprofit founded by second wave feminists in the 1980s, and we still hold very close to that tradition. We now have a trans health program with over 150 patients. The culture change you created around this issue is what makes that possible. I talk about this because fights like marriage equality, which on its surface seem really heteronormative, have the benefit of creating a halo effect and changing a homophobic and biphobic and transphobic culture. It makes queer people visible. It brings to light unequal treatment and starts a societal conversation that can and should be taken advantage of. Because while the involvement of the state in my personal relationship kind of horrifies me as an anarchist, if I can utilize the fight to broaden the conversation to something beyond marriage, I'm going to do it. Now, that said, I'm going to shock some of you by saying something. I've recently become somewhat of a fan of traditional marriage. Before I get booed off stage, I want to read something and see if anyone knows where this comes from. If my husband was timid, neither would it be fitting for us to be together, for single-handed I am victorious in battles and contests and combats, and it would be a reproach to my husband that his wife should be more courageous than he. But it is no reproach if they are equally courageous, provided that both are courageous. If the man with whom I should be with were jealous, neither would it be fitting, for I was never without one lover quickly succeeding another. Who knows what this is from? Oh, come on, you're going to make the Americans say this? This is from the first chapter of the time.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is what marriage was. When folks at that institute, I'm afraid of calling homophobic because who knows, I might get sued for it, go and use the phrase traditional marriage, I have to ask, whose tradition are they really talking about? Certainly not theirs. Certainly not the litigants in Hassan and another versus MJELR. Hassan, a Lebanese Irish citizen whose traditional allowed polygamous marriage, was not allowed to have his other wife come into the state because the Irish High Court decided that, no, this isn't traditional marriage, which I find very, very kind of funny because polygamous marriage in this country was, up until 1605, part of law. So when we talk about marriage as an institution, I'm very much, I separate the two. Marriage being my personal relationships with people versus marriage, this institution that really is kind of only about 200 years old and mainly focused around property rights. So I think in closing, I'm supportive of this. But I think this can be leveraged. And I think from a tactical standpoint, it needs to be leveraged to further this conversation.
Great, thanks. Okay, cheers to all the speakers on the panel. So two things. One is that Andrew here is going to pass around evaluation sheets. Is that what they are?
No, not me, it's somebody over there.
Oh, sorry, yeah. Okay.
Feedback sheets.
Feedback, not evaluation. Feedback sheets you can hang on to. If anybody wants to tweet this event, the Wi-Fi password here is darkroom1, and it's hashtag DABF. So feel free to do that. I think some people would be very happy if you did. And so, yeah, take some questions now, and, you know, if people would like to do that, please do, and, you know, reasonable level of self-regulation would be great, if you can try not to do the 10-minute monologues as well. So, I don't know, is there anyone who wants to kick it off? Thanks. Oh, just before you start, if there's a particular person you're asking a question of, just kind of say their name or point to them if you can't remember, or if it's for the whole panel, just say that as well.
I have a lot of criticisms, obviously, of the marriage equality campaign, because they've really sold the heteronormative, obedient, straightest gay possible scenario she did, like, to a fault of railroading over the rest of us. To when this campaign finishes, where are we? You know, we're kind of alienated by this stream of people coming in and being radicalised, but at the same time we're being alienated from them too. And when it ends, where do they go? Because they've suddenly been radicalised into something. And rather than having the space to explore that and explore themselves in a queer spectrum, they've kind of been told, well, yeah, you find someone you love, they're the same sex, and you get married and everything's dandy and rosy. And the idea of even the constitution and defending the constitution or amending the constitution, because their constitution is appalling. You know what I mean? It's not really something worth defending. It should be completely demolished and started again. And let me see. And what about I have no mention of the queer kids. Where are the queer kids with queer parents? Don't mention it. It's not allowed to be mentioned. Our kids cannot, we couldn't possibly, we want to hide that in case we're buying into other people's ideas. So what if we have queer kids? Do you know what I mean? And I just want to say that I'm really bloody angry, and I will be voting yes, and at the start of the campaign I was quite excited about voting yes because it meant I could avail of these automatic rights, almost the marriage privilege, which is a problem in itself. And then they bring forward the children's bill or whatever, which kind of obsoletes that purpose. So I would be quite critical, and I'm a bit alienated and wondering where we go after this, and if we lose, which is quite a possibility, and people are really delusional to think that we are winning. If we lose, what happens? What does that mean when we are rejected by society as a whole? And I just wonder if anyone has really any answers for this. And just on the last comment, asexuality, equating that with being single isn't the case. You know, asexual people have relationships, and it was an unfair comment, I think.
I meant that in regards to when people see me, I'm cis, and my pronouns
are,
I know, but my pronouns are her and she. But because I'm bisexual, if people see me, I'm the person I'm in a relationship that is male, they assume I'm heterosexual. If people see me and the person I'm in a relationship with is female, they assume that I'm homosexual. Then that's not the case. It's like saying, because I'm single, I would be asexual. I'm not having to go with asexual people, and I know people who are asexual and romantic and bi-romantic. In terms of where we go from here for fighting, we need to fight for... Do you know that the couples counselling and marriage counselling in this country, the biggest funded NGO for that is Accord, and they are the Catholic marriage counselling services. They also teach relationships workshops in our schools. I got a phone call telling my children to come home from school early because there was a group in to teach them about relationships, and it was a cord. And I wasn't told, and the children weren't told, and I actually pulled my kids out to talk to them because they get a say in what the external people coming in, they get a say. And they weren't even told it was the Catholic organisation coming in to stop relationships. And they did a full two-hour workshops. The entire day was took up, and LGBT people weren't mentioned until the very last throwaway comment. We do not have the services to support people in same-sex relations in this country. We don't have the counsellors, we don't have the supports. We need a radical changing of all of the things that married people interface with, be it the civil service, be it the medical professionals. Everything needs to change in order to accommodate queer people and people in queer and different relationships. In regards to children, it's a big thing. You know, I told both of mine, look, they said, my son came to me and said, Mom, am I gay? When he was 10. I don't know. He says, what do you mean you don't know? You always told me you knew me before I was born. I said, yeah, but your sexuality will develop as you get older. And I'd like to think that when you figure it out, you'll be okay with telling me. And I think that's how all children should be raised. And not just in terms of sexuality, but also with gender. But we don't have, our infrastructure is too heteronormative. And it really needs to change, and they're what we need to push for. Getting the yes, the right to vote, marriage equality, hopefully when it does pass. These structural things are the next things we need to queer.
Is there any other... Thanks. So any other comments from the panel on that? We can keep going.
Brief comment on just on the kids thing, because I like what you said about, like, why are we scared to say our children might grow up queer? Why are we accepting, like, why are we accepting the homophobic premise behind the idea that we should be ashamed of that or act as if that's undesirable? And I think, like, the marriage equality campaign, like, they're running it in a way that they don't want to talk about children at all. And, like, there's all this stuff about, like, how, oh, no, this referendum's not about kids because that's been dealt with by the, like, whatever the bill is called. I can't remember what the bill is called. And really, that seems to be definitive of the whole tone of the campaign. It's like, let's not rock the boat, let's not upset the homophobes in this society by saying that, like, that queer relationships might involve children, or that we might want to have children and we might want to raise children. And I find it really weird because, like, do we think we can't win that argument? Like the no sides argument is really, really flimsy. It's like, they call it sexual complementarity, and it's the idea that, like, there's something unique about the relationship between a man and a woman because of, like, what men are like and what women are like. And, like, it's really easy to, like, just ask the Ireland Institute, like, in what respects are all women different from all men? And watch them squirm and try not to say something horrendously sexist, because they can't, because the argument is ridiculous. So, like, I hate the way this is being fought. It's being fought in a way that's pandering to like, homophobia. And I think, like, it's not just if we win, it's, like, how we win is crucial in this.
Thanks. So a quick comment from Paul, and then I'll take another question.
One of the things I don't want to happen after the referendum is something that Aidan suggested, which is that the queer community distances itself from ordinary LGBT people, because I want radical arguments to be heard among a lot of LGBT people. I don't want there to be a respectable wing and a left-wing activist wing. And I think, like, some kid growing up isolated in a rural area needs to have a bigger movement than a small bunch of left-wing activists with very pure ideas. They need to get the message that they are allowed to exist. And so I think we need to stay in dialogue with the rest of the LGBT movement and not allow ourselves to be silenced out of it. We need to keep saying, look, marriage is not the be-all and end-all, and gender binary is not the be-all and end-all.
So somebody at the back here has a question or a comment or whatever?
Yeah, I don't know. I just wanted to say a few things. A lot of things that you said, I agree with, and that was, like, a lot that I was thinking about as well. But, like, this sort of, like, campaign just, like, reminds me of, like, the abortion, like, campaign. And I just feel like, yeah, it just never led anywhere, really. And, like, the movement has, like, died. In some way, and I'm just, like, wondering, like, how this time it is actually going to be different. So, like, yes, we're all going to vote yes, or whoever is going to vote is going to vote yes, and we're sort of, like, talking about how, like, important it is, but I felt that, like, we're getting fooled, and that we're not actually spending our energy and, like, focusing on, like, what else we could do, because maybe, like, I don't know, maybe this referendum is a first step. But it's definitely not, like, reaching, like, equality, as they call it. And, like, I felt really uncomfortable with them calling it that, because I think this is really restrictive and this is definitely not what it is. And, like, I just wonder how, like, we as, like, I don't know, sorry, that's just the first thing that comes to my mind, but maybe you want to call it differently, but, like, maybe as active anarchists or, like, people who do actually want to have, like, a social revolution, how can we push things forward and not within the limits of the legislation? But how, like, I don't know, how do we make it more obvious? How do we make it clear that this is not just what we want, that we don't just want to conform to, like, yes, okay, marriage for equality, that's great, and then it dies? I just wonder, like, realistically, what do we do afterwards, and how do we, like, link all the different struggles? Because it's not just, like, I don't know, in France it was called, like, same-sex marriage, and it happened, I don't know what to call here, but like if that's like that's not the only struggle, it just extends to like queer, trans, and other people with other gender, other identification, with abortion, with loads of different things like that. And I do feel that we need to be a bit more, I don't know, like active about it rather than being passive and just being like, yeah, all right, they passed the law and that's where I am now.
Would you like an answer from anyone particular on the panel, or is that kind of a question for us in the room to think about?
Yeah, I don't really know. It's just something that like bothers me, and like I'd like to just, I don't know, maybe this is appropriate now because we're in a room full of people, but maybe that's the time where we actually just all get together, maybe in the future, and actually do something that is gonna like, I don't know, show our presence and show that like no matter like how much we can agree with the, I don't know, the referendum, and like even if we vote yes, then afterwards how do we push forwards to actually get our fucking rights and get heard? And is it something we can do at the march with like, I don't know, banners supporting like, I don't know, queers or trans or people who don't, like, I don't know, just loads of different things, how can we raise awareness?
Yeah. Is that similar to what you were saying earlier, Aidan, about everyone in the room kind of who are critical kind of coming together?
Yeah,
like,
I mean, I guess maybe just to respond a little bit to what Paul said, because I think that also plays into this, like, not wanting a split between the queers and the mainstream movement. I think the split's already happened, but we're not recognising it. Like, the problem at the moment is that we're, like, isolated pockets of queers talking to the mainstream, going, you're not including us, you're not recognising our unique issues in your propaganda or whatever. And what I would like is for there to be an autonomous queer movement that's together, that can say these things, not with one voice, but from a position of strength and relate to that mainstream movement, like not as individuals, but as some sort of like really cool amorphous collective sort of thing. So we need to be getting together, and we need to be talking to each other, and we need to be finding ways to turn our ideas and our needs and our desires and our hopes and our dreams into something we can practically start to push forward.
Thanks. Is there anyone else who has anything on that? Or we move on? You do, yeah? Great.
I think that we need to have a lot more conversations and stuff about it, and something that we've started doing up north, we started hosting these conversations so that people could get together who have certain ideas and we could discuss them a bit more and inform them. It's a great way of organising and bringing this stuff back into the mainstream, and I think that's what we need to do. We actually need to be talking about this stuff because there is an awful lot of silencing, and we really need to make ourselves heard, and we need to shake things up. And there are people in the marriage equality movement who I would identify as my class enemy. It doesn't really matter to me if, you know, they are queer or whatever. That whenever the revolution comes, like, these are going to be the people who aren't on our side. And as it stands now, there is this tiny part of this that is radical because it is redefining things and all the rest of it, and it's breaking away from the church and all the social norms that we have. But these aren't people who I would consider comrades. I wouldn't consider them allies. And we, like Aidan said, there has been a split, and we haven't acknowledged it. And I think that split needs to be more prominent.
There's a question here in the middle.
Yeah, so...
Our comment.
Yeah, I guess question and comment. Just to say, I mean, first of all, that I think I agree with what most of what was said, actually. My question or comments would be that, in terms of a position, it's very similar, I suppose, to the various positions that were outlined. But there seems to me some inconsistency in what was said. So, I mean, Paul, for example, I mean, when you're talking about the importance of choice and respecting people's individual choices, you know, even if they differ from yours, it seems to me that understanding of marriage, you know, as a choice, something that somebody can choose to enter into, and we respect that choice, it doesn't really take sufficient account of the institutional nature of marriage and its consequences for people who choose not to marry. I mean, because of the state benefits, etc., which are attached to the institution of marriage, that has consequences for people who choose not to marry. So, I mean, I think that raises all sorts of questions. I agree with you, but I think it raises questions, you know, about the consistency of that position of supporting individual choice. And it's a very similar comment that I would have, you know, to Fionnghuala, is that, again, I agree with you, but if you really, you know, think that the institution of marriage, you know, is a horrible institution, you know, that it's as you know, anarcho-feminist literature for a long time has described it as a form of slavery, right? But if you believe that, you know, why would you support, you know, would you support, for example, somebody's right to become a slave owner, right? I mean, if that's how you see the institution. So, I mean, that it seems to me that then, you know, Aidan's argument and Bethany's argument are more consistent in the sense that, you know, you're arguing from a sort of a tactical position, right? I guess, you know, Aidan's argument there is that the queer movement simply doesn't have the strength, political strength, at the present time in Ireland to push through more radical changes. So I thought that's more consistent, but then it's also very fuzzy in the sense that, you know, so strategically or tactically, you know, how are you going to build that movement by, you know, supporting the yes vote? So, for example, you know, just this is what I'll end on. If the argument is that we're opening up space for conversation, well, I think everything that's been said today suggests that the sort of conversations we're having in this room are, you know, not conversations which are being had with the mainstream, in the mainstream. So, you know, those are isolated conversations. So my tactical question there is, you know, how are you going to, you know, how will those sort of conversations enter the mainstream? Isn't the reverse going to happen? Those positions are going to become more marginal.
So can I, if you don't mind, ask you to pull that together or maybe focus on one element of that rather than kind of one question to each person that you'd like for the panel? Or would you like a response to the whole thing?
No, because each guy, so I was directing to each, you know, person individually, I suppose, responding to, so I don't want to put it into one question. And, you know, if anybody chooses to respond to that, they can.
Yeah, maybe. I suppose what I just meant was because there's a lot of people in the room, I don't want, like, five questions. But if we just go at what's... See, I think everyone wants to respond. It might kind of bring us to the end.
I'll be really quick. Thank you. Make those conversations happen by getting involved in the Yes Equality campaign. You make those conversations happen with the mainstream by forcing them. I've been in meetings and I've worn my bi-visibility pin, which I got from Robin Ox when she was over here and did workshops. And I stood up in that room and said, this also affects me, bisexual people under equal rights as well. And I've seen a shift in the groups around the country, the individual groups. I've been invited to go speak down in Cork. I've had other people invited from the Bi Ireland Plus Network. It's a group of non-monosexuals. So you be there, be present, queer it, but the conversation happens by going into those spaces. If they're saying that, you know, this includes you too, or it doesn't really include you, be there, be present, have those conversations. I wear my Bi Visibility pin, and I wear my Abortion Rights Campaign pin, and I wear the Vote Yes pin when I'm going door to door in the area that I live canvassing. So be visible, make those conversations happen. Like I said, be a thorn in their side. If they don't want to mention these issues or they don't want to mention problematic, be in those spaces and push that agenda, push those conversations, make them happen.
Okay, other responses?
I think one of the problems when you're talking about a win from a cultural context is that wins like this happen very slowly, so you don't notice that you're already winning until you've actually won. And it's kind of weird. Like, let me give you an example. The number of people in Europe getting married from 1975 to now has reduced by 38%. So the concept of what that means, what people should do when they want to, you know, couple or whatever, has slowly over the past 40 years changed. So I think there's two conversations that are happening, the cultural conversation. What does being in a relationship mean? What does marriage mean? And the rights conversation. When I specifically make a distinction between the institution of marriage, which is the granting of rights by the state, versus the kind of like warm, fuzzy marriage type, which is people's personal relationships. And I think this has been shifting over the years, and you know, especially within the last 40 years. And if we can decouple those and start having that broader conversation where what does relationships look like? What does this mean to be granted? Every time someone sits there and makes like an argument about marriage, I am always the first to say, so in other words, you want the state to be like able to come into my bedroom. And no one wants that. You know, and I can make this argument with the most conservative person in the world and get some sort of common ground with them. But I really think going into those communities and changing the conversation and changing what the conversation looks like. Because right now it's yay rights, yay equal rights, blah, 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 versus, well, wait a second, why does the state have a right to tell me all this anyway? This makes no sense. Getting involved in the Yes campaign, getting involved in local queer communities, getting involved in local LGBT communities, and changing that conversation. And just real quickly, I want to give an example of this. Trans anarchist ladies are not very common. And 20 years ago, there weren't very many of us. Last year, I was at the Philly Trans Health Conference, and I sat in a bar with 40 of us. And it was amazing because I was like, wait a second, where the hell did you all come from? And it was this 18, 20-year process of having the conversation and being able to create this culture of resistance. And that takes time. It takes time to build. It's not going to come tomorrow. We may never see it. I probably won't see it. But having that conversation, continuing to have that conversation, even when it annoys the living daylights out of people, just have that conversation continually.
Great. So anyone else, you obviously want to respond? Yeah, go for it.
Yeah,
this.
I just want to clarify that the kind of choice I'm talking about is not a capitalist consumer Pepsi or Coca-Cola kind of imagined free choice. I'm talking about difficult options that people have to pragmatically take tactically at the moment. Like, I want to get rid of all borders, you know, and have free migration across the planet. But at the moment, if somebody who's queer doesn't have the right to use marriage as a tactic to gain residency, then that means that they are going to be deported when their straight neighbour might not be deported. And that's the kind of choice I'm talking about. I'm not talking about the consumerist, like, oh, everyone's wall colour is sacred, you know.
Would you guys like to, yeah?
I just want to talk about what you said there in your point. I think the feminist movement has really dropped the ball with marriage, and I think that it should have, like, its discourse on marriage, feminist discourse, is really, it's virtually non-existent these days, and I think that it's now the responsibility of queer feminists who would be of the same mindset as me, that it is slavery and all the rest of it, and to highlight the horrors contained within the history of it, to come out and say, and to call it what it is, really, like, we're naming names here, and it's important to do that. And I think whenever the yes vote is called, then that's maybe the time for straight feminists to come back into it and support us in the argument against it. But obviously, as an anarchist, I feel people know best how to govern their own situation, which is why I would never stop someone getting married. Obviously, I think if anyone's fully informed of what marriage is and what marriage currently is and what it was, I don't think anyone who would be of the same ideals would want to get married. I don't really think anybody, unless they do want to actually go into slavery, would want to get married. But that's just... And the other reason that I would be calling for yes vote is because I wouldn't have been able to imagine what it would be like for me growing up as a child wanting to get married to someone and knowing, but having been told, no, you can't, because I would be loving someone who doesn't fit the norm. So that's the only reason that I would be saying we should have a yes vote.
No, I just want to move on. Do you?
I'll be really like. So, is it inconsistent to advocate a yes vote and talk about the need for? Like, yeah, sure. But this is happening whether we like it or not, and it's a question of like figuring out what the least irresponsible, least bad choice to make is. And I think in this context, if there were a no vote, like number one, people who need specific rights would not get those rights. But also, it would be read as a social rejection of queer people, and would embolden and strengthen homophobes. And I think we don't want that situation. What does building this movement look like? I mean, for me personally, like my ability to live as the person I am is like largely enabled by the fact that like the punk community and like the squatter community, which I'm involved in, are like really pro-queer and really supportive, and that allows me like a certain degree of safety to be this person. So I think we need spaces like that for people who aren't crusty punks, and that happens organically by people getting together and starting to like do stuff together, whether that's political stuff, whether that's just a bunch of queers hanging out, but like it's all positive, and it all pushes towards a situation where we can start to look at challenging power.
Thanks. Can I check then how many questions or comments are left in the room? I'm kind of worried I haven't seen the one anymore. We've like 15 minutes. Two anymore? Okay, do you want to go for it?
I think is for Benula, is it? Yeah. You mentioned something a bit interesting that because you're based in Belfast, you're mentioning how kind of the political situation in Northern Ireland with the DUP being very openly homophobic in how a lot of its ministers kind of comments that they come out with. And kind of I think in the Republic we're not really as much having that kind of state kind of sponsored homophobia, it's more so from, say, groups like the Ione Institute. And that kind of also goes to, say, abortion rights in both North and South. How do you feel with, say, the Westminster elections coming up, and how it's really going to be looking like a coalition government's going to be brought into play, and how perhaps the DUP could be brought into that fold and given a greater say in how that state is run? Point being is that what could you kind of go into a bit more about that and how kind of is it kind of the state elected representatives in Northern Ireland being openly homophobic, and do you think that in Northern Ireland they're kind of a bit further back than the South in how kind of gay rights and gay liberation is it being held back more, or are we still on the same?
Yeah, it's interesting. Kind of ties in with what Monkey was asking about. Whenever if it's a vote, no, if it's a no vote, where do we go from there?
Sure, yeah.
Because we are in a situation where last April, for the third time, marriage equality was voted down, and we still remain the only part of the UK where marriage equality isn't legal. And it would be disastrous if the DUP was to become a junior party in the coalition. And, there's good and bad sides. Obviously, I think they would be exposed as the bigots and whatever else you want to call them, that they really are. And but what I can't understand is, so last June, we had Pastor McConnell, who's a DUP supporter, calling all Muslims terrorists, and then we had Peter Robinson, the First Minister, coming out and backing him up and saying that they're not all bad, I would trust them to go to shops for me, like, you know, that was his justification of it. And then you had Paul Gittin, a minister, coming out with this idea for the conscience clause, and he was the health minister, and there was a court case taken against him because we're still the only part of the UK which upholds the ban on gay men donating blood. And his case was, oh, it's for health reasons and all the rest of it, but whenever Justice Tracy ruled against it and said it was homophobic and it has to change, his response was, this is another attack on religious people. So it's hardly a health matter here, it's clearly religious. And so I can't understand why they still are the majority party. Like, because there are other unionist parties, some more right-wing than the others, some slightly more progressive, like the PUP, who definitely aren't great anyway. But I don't understand why this happened, because last Saturday we held an action outside of Asher's Bakery, the bakery that Gay Cake Riot, as they're calling it, emerged from. And there was a few people who looked absolutely repulsed by us and called us pathetic. And my job was meant to be stopping people from going in and asking them, sorry, are you queer? It's Rainbow Saturdays, only queer people allowed. But then I had people going to me, no, it's not, you're pathetic, get out of the way. I had one man push me. But then there was lots and lots of positive response and a lot of people coming up to us. And it's actually really funny, there was an older couple came up to us and I thought, oh, Jesus, this is going to be trouble. But just by the way, they were walking up and, you know, this old stereotype or whatever. And the man said this, do you have any gluten-free? And I says, well, sorry, we didn't thought. And he says, see, you have to be inclusive. That's their problem. It's not meant to be yours. So there is a considerable amount of support for the queer community. Maybe it's just the institutions that have a bit of power that are coming out and saying this, like, Ashers and all the rest of it, and the Girls Brigade. So I'd say there are certain elements of it that are a lot more radical in their homophobia and their heteronormativity than what they would be down here.
Thanks. Question at the back.
I was just going to say that two members of the panel said when it passes, and I just think this is extraordinary optimism. 1995, the divorce referendum, 6 weeks out, 74%, the polls were suggesting 74% yes, that passed by 51%. So I don't think we can really be that complacent that it would pass. I think when we put these debates around marriage equality to referendum, if you look at it internationally, it's incredibly, incredibly unsuccessful. I mean, it would be a miracle, and we would really stand out if Irish people actually passed that and just relate that then back to the campaign. I feel like just have to kind of defend the marriage equality campaign just a little bit, in that when you look at this is not an internal conversation, we're not trying to convince ourselves to vote yes, we're trying to convince a very kind of broad section of the population, a very traditional heterosexual section of the population. We know when we do these sort of polls and what they respond to and what they don't respond to. I know we don't like that. It's called marriage equality, it's not called same-sex marriage, because people don't want to think about sex and gay people. And I'm sorry, that's brutal, but that's actually, they don't want to talk about children because children's another race. So we remove this. Yes, it's mainstreaming. No, there's an issue about how we should win if we win. Anyway.
Do you have a question or just you'd be happy with responses?
Yeah,
you're straight in there.
Marriage equality can do it without throwing other people under the bus. I'm sorry. We're not bisexuals are not just being ignored and erased. We've been actively thrown under the bus by the campaign. I have had people who've been on the steering committee for marriage equality email me and catch me on Twitter and tell me that if the yes vote failed, it's because of troublemakers like me causing a split in the campaign and the other side will latch onto it. And I should not be such a keyboard warrior. I'm not just a keyboard warrior. I run the Yes Equality campaign Facebook for my district. I'm involved in the meetings. When I'm optimistic, it's because I've been out on the doorsteps with my red coat and my purple umbrella. So I get the mainstream and I understand that, but I am sick to the teeth of privileged, cis, gay men telling me I'm doing it wrong and asking me to shut up. That's the problem. And when we queer the conversations and when we are visible and when we poke them, you're going to get that. You're going to get told, oh, well, no, don't cause a fuss, dear. And I'm like, if I'm not causing a fuss and I'm not upsetting somebody, I'm doing it wrong.
I understand the concept between wanting to win and wanting to be right. I want to be both. And sometimes you have to make that very difficult difficult decision whether I want to win or whether I want to be right. I'm going to be a little bit North American centric again. 1997, I think it was, Sylvia Rivera was on her deathbed. Empire State, New York State, gay and lesbian, theoretically trans and bi rights organization was pushing through a equal rights bill that was not trans inclusive. Their claim was they couldn't get it passed, we'll come back for you. This year, they decided it was okay to come back for us. In those 15 years between that, trans women were murdered in New York. One of the highest rates of unemployment. So I have been thrown under the bus so often by American gay and lesbian groups that I can rebuild the damn tranny under it. Oh, come on, that was funny. I understand the concept of wanting to win, and I get it. There's a history of that being under the bus and going, yeah, we'll come back for you, and they never do. If there was an assurance that, yeah, you know, you're right. You know, just kind of chill out and, you know, not make up too big of a fuss and, you know, we'll come back and look at this and actually spend energy on it. Sure, I'd be great. But that insurance better be written in blood, because after 20-some-odd years of queer activism, I know every time someone says, we'll come back for you, they disappear. It's really funny. They just go poof. It's like they're from damn Hogwarts or something.
I think those, like what you were saying, those kind of, like, tactical concessions to homophobia, like, that makes sense if the only thing you care about is this referendum passing. That's not my politics. What I want is a world where kids growing up like me don't have to go through the same level of shit that I had to go through. So I don't want to make any concessions to people who are disgusted by the idea of me having sex. I don't want to make any concessions to people who are disgusted by the idea of me being allowed to raise children. Fuck that.
Just because this kind of topic or this kind of conflict is what this session is about, maybe I'll just ask if either of you the two would like to say anything, and if not, we can. You're happy to leave it. Is there any burning issues, or is everyone kind of happy with that? I kind of feel like it kind of comes together nicely.
Also, don't just... Sorry. Yeah. Also, don't just queer gay spaces. I'm a very out person. One of my friends called me out of my garrison. I'm involved in my local community. I'm on the board of management of my local community centre. I'm involved with my local community radio. So, yes, it's hard to go into capitalist, cis, hetero communities. Yes, it could be hard to find support in those places. But it's easier to do now than it was for me to do 20 years ago. So I won't have somebody say I'm lesser because I'm not married. I won't have somebody say I'm lesser because I'm bi. I won't have somebody say I'm lesser because I'm an unmarried parent. You know, believe in yourself and push into the conversation. Yes, there's a part where people say it's mainstreaming, but we're queering it as we go.
All right. Big thank you to the panel. Woo! Big thank you to the audience.